ليلة المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى. إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله لنريه من آياتنا إنه هو السميع البصير. وآتينا موسى الكتاب وجعلناه هدى لبني إسرائيل ألا تتخذوا من دونه ألا تتخذوا من دوني وكيلا. ذرية من حملنا مع نوح إنه كان عبدا شكورا. وقضينا إلى بني إسرائيل في الكتاب لتفسدن في الأرض مرتين في الأرض مرتين ولتعلن علوا كبيرا. فإذا جاء وقت أولاهما بعثنا عليكم عبادا لنا أولي بأس شديد. فجاسوا خلال الديار وكان وعدا مفعولا. ثم رددنا لكم الكرة عليهم وأمددناهم بأموال وبنين وجعلناكم أكثر نفيرا. صدق الله العلي العظيم.
اللهم صل على
أطراف أهكم بذكر محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. أزور سيدي ومولاي أبا عبد الله الحسين أصالة عن نفسي ونيابة عن والدي ووالد والدي وجميع المؤمنين والمؤمنات المسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات ومن أوصانا بالدعاء. اللهم تقبل أعمالنا بخير قبول. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله، السلام عليك ابن رسول الله، السلام عليك ابن أمير المؤمنين وابن سيد الوصيين، السلام عليك ابن فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين، السلام عليك يا ثار الله وابن ثاره والوتر الموتور. أشهد السلام عليك وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك. عليكم مني جميعا سلام الله، أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار. يا أبا عبد الله، لقد عظمت الرزية وجلت وعظمت المصيبة بك علينا وعلى جميع أهل الإسلام، وجلت وعظمت مصيبتك في السماوات على جميع أهل السماوات. فلعن الله أمة أسست أساس الظلم والجور عليكم أهل البيت، ولعن الله أمة دفعتكم عن مقامكم وأزالتكم عن مراتبكم التي رتبكم الله فيها، ولعن الله أمة قتلتكم، ولعن الله الممهدين لهم بالتمكين من قتالكم. برئت إلى الله وإليكم منهم ومن أشياعهم وأتباعهم وأوليائهم. يا أبا عبد الله، إني سلم لمن سالمكم وحرب لمن حاربكم إلى يوم القيامة. ولعن الله آل زياد وآل مروان، ولعن الله بني أمية خاطبة، ولعن الله ابن مرجان، ولعن الله عمر بن سعد، ولعن الله شمران، ولعن الله أمة أسرجت وألجمت وتنقبت لقتالك. بأبي أنت وأمي، لقد عظم يا مصابي بك، فأسأل الله الذي أكرم مقامك وأكرمني بك أن يرزقني طلب أثارك مع إمام منصور من أهل بيت محمد صلى الله عليه وآله. اللهم اجعلني عندك وجيها بالحسين عليه السلام في الدنيا والآخرة. يا أبا عبد الله، إني أتقرب إلى الله وإلى رسوله وإلى أمير المؤمنين وإلى فاطمة الزهراء وإلى الحسن وإليك بموالاتك وبالبراءة ممن قاتلك ونصب لك الحرب، وبالبراءة ممن أسس أساس الظلم عليه والجور عليكم. أبرأ إلى الله وإلى رسوله ممن أسس أساس ذلك وبنى عليه بنيانه وجرى في ظلمه وجوره عليكم وعلى أشياعكم. برئت إلى الله وإليكم منهم وأتقرب إلى الله ثم إليكم بموالاتكم وموالاتي وليكم وبالبراءة من أعدائكم والناصبين لكم الحق وبالبراءة من أشياعهم وأتباعهم إني سلم لمن سالمكم وحرب لمن حاربكم وولي لمن والاكم وعدو لمن عاداكم فأسأل الله الذي أكرمني بمعرفتكم ومعرفة أوليائكم ورزقني البراءة من أعدائكم أن يجعلني معكم في الدنيا والآخرة وأن يثبت لي عندكم قدم صدق في الدنيا والآخرة وأسأله أن يبلغني المقام المحمود لكم عند الله وأن يرزقني طلب تأليم مع إمام هدى ظاهر ناطق بالحق منكم وأسأل الله بحقكم وبالشأن الذي لكم عنده أن يعطيني بمصابي بكم أفضل ما يعطي مصابا بمصيبته مصيبة ما أعظمها وأعظم رزيتها في الإسلام وفي جميع السماوات والأرض اللهم اجعلني في مقامي هذا ممن تناله منك صلوات ورحمة ومغفرة اللهم اجعل محياي محيا محمد وآل محمد ومماتي ممات محمد وآل محمد اللهم إن هذا يوم تبركت به بنو أمية وابن أكلة الأكباد اللعين ابن اللعين على لسانك ولسان نبيك صلى الله عليه وآله في كل موطن وموقف وقف فيه نبيك صلى الله عليه وآله اللهم لعن أبا سفيان ومعاوية ويزيد بن معاوية عليهم منك اللعنة أبد الآبدين وهذا يوم فرحت به آل زياد وآل مروان بقتلهم الحسين صلى الله عليه وآله اللهم فضاعف عليهم اللعنة منك والعذاب الأليم اللهم إني أتقرب إليك في هذا اليوم وفي موقفي هذا وأيام حياتي بالبراءة منهم واللعنة عليهم وبالموالاة لنبيك وآل نبيك عليه وعليهم السلام اللهم العن أول ظالم ظلم حق محمد وآل محمد وآخر تابع له على ذلك اللهم العن العصابة التي جاهدت الحسين وشايعت وبايعت وتابعت على قتله اللهم العنهم جميعا ما تبرك السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى إخوان الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين جميعا ما تبرك اللهم خص أنت أول ظالم باللعن مني، وابدأ به أولا ثم العن الثاني والثالث والرابع. اللهم العن يزيد خامسا، والعن عبيد الله بن زياد وابن مرجان وعمر بن سعد وشمرا وآل أبي سفيان وآل زياد وآل مروان إلى يوم القيامة. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد.
صل على محمد وآل محمد.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
السلام.
عظم الله أجورنا وأجوركم بمصافحة أبي عبد الله الحسين. First, I want to make a few announcements, inshallah. From now on until Muharram, until Arba'een, we're going to have every Friday and Saturday. Inshallah, Friday we'll start at 6:30, we'll pray, 7 o'clock, we start our majlis. Inshallah, Saturday we start with the Maghribi prayer after the weekend school, inshallah. Still, the days open for all those weekend until the Arba'een for sponsorship. However, the weekend after next weekend, inshallah, is going to be Thanksgiving. And we have a visitor speaker from Florida, inshallah. He's going to, we have, inshallah, the majlis on Thursday night, Thursday evening, Friday evening, Saturday evening, and inshallah, we have Sunday evening.
If I'm back, inshallah.
If Hajji might be back, inshallah. We will let you know the inshallah. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali
Muhammad. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
The task given event, inshallah, is going to be the event for the memory of Imam Ali ibn Hussein alayhi salam. So, inshallah, we try to celebrate it as much as we can. We still have the sponsorship open for us. The timing, inshallah, for the when the Maulana visit is going to be from Maghribi day. So we assume everybody is off on Thanksgiving day. So inshallah, we start from 5:30. We pray and we have the Quran and we start, inshallah, the business. That mostly about our announcement. However, we have in Arba'een, the Arba'een inshallah will land on the Christmas time. So we have a visitor speaker coming from Michigan. Inshallah, we have three more nights. Inshallah, we have that for the Arba'een. So still, except the Arba'een day is. We have sponsored the round evening is still open. So just to let you know about it, inshallah. Alhamdulillah, we finished the, this is the 13th night, which is the day of burial of the bodies of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, his companion, his Al-Baydin. So, which Imam Sajjad alayhi salam came back for that occasion with the help of Bani Asad, the tribe of Asad. And I don't want to say anything about it because I don't want to take the credit for Hajj Bani Asad. You know, to take that part, inshallah. One thing I would like to mention, I was on the internet wandering around. And subhanAllah, I was there's some website from Europe, and the ma'tam and the aza there is incredible. I saw a bus with the double levels. It's have all painted in black, and it's have Ya Hussein on it in Arabic and in English, and a lot of statement in English about Imam Hussein and who is Imam Hussein. There is a lot of centers of Husseiniyya they show in there, especially in the Eastern Europe and Belgium, those aliens. It's amazing. I do believe sometimes if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts some catastrophe on us, there is a reason behind it. And when Saddam Hussein was in Iraq and put all that pressure on the people to let them refuge to somewhere else, those old refugees went to Europe. They create their own community. Mashallah, it's become, it looks like all Europe become Shia. This is amazing. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for purpose do something we don't know. It's painful for us, but the result of it is maybe something is more beneficial for the Islam and for our Ahlul Bayt followers, inshallah. So, I wonder if we have any point here. Please sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ala
Muhammad.
That's fine. I'm not worthy of sitting on the bed. Salaam. Trust me, I heard that. Salaam. So this is the poetry of one of my very good friends. His name is Majid Akhtar. He lives in Los Angeles. And his whole family is Sunni. He's one of in the living people, he's a great Mercyite. I've talked with him a lot. He has never told me that he's Shia. But if he's not Shia, I don't know. If I am a Shia, I'll tell you his poetry. So he once told me this very beautiful story about his life, that in LA, somebody has invited a great peace, great, you know, saint from Iraq. And he went to meet him. So he didn't know that saint. He has never met him. He said, you know, when I entered in a big room, that preserve that peer was sitting far, and the moment I entered, he said, there is the lover of Janab Fatima. And I came and he told me, just write poetry in praise of Janab Fatima. So he has been doing ever since that. So one of that is Zikre Sipte Sayyidun Khairun Vara Karta. ذکر سکتے سید خیر برا کرتا تھا شیر کہتا تھا کہ گویا معجزہ کرتا تھا شیر کہتا تھا کہ گویا معجزہ کرتا تھا رات اور مدحت آل نبی میں بیت جائے زندگی بارگاہ قبلہ میں یہ دعا کرتا تھا اور ہو سخن ارزر اضافہ ہو میری توفیق میں شہر علم و آگہی سے التجا کرتا تھا اور جانے کب فکر و نظر کی منزلیں طے ہو گئی جانے کب فکر و نظر کی منزلیں طے ہو گئی میں تو ورد یا علی مشکل کشا کرتا تھا اور میرے پھیلائے ہوئے دامن کی وسعت تنگ تھی میرے پھیلائے ہوئے دامن کی وسعت تنگ تھی مجھ پہ اتنی بخششیں دستے سخا کر اور گھر میرا فردوس میں تعمیر کرتے تھے ملک گھر میرا فردوس میں تعمیر کرتے تھے ملک میں سنائے دل بھری خیر المسا کرتا تھا اور یہ شعر خاص طور پہ پلیز جسٹ دس از اباؤٹ ہاؤ دا ہارٹ ساؤنڈ کمز ٹو یو ان دا نائٹ Like thak thak thak. So just keep that in mind. Yun laga kamre se aati hai sadaye ya Husain. Yun laga kamre se aati hai sadaye ya Husain. Yun laga jaise koi dil mein aza karta tha. Yun laga jaise koi dil mein aza karta tha. Par wahon aur waswason ke phunk kar saare chala. ایک چراغ موت بھر کیسی ضیا کرتا تھا رات اور یا حسینہ یا حسینہ یا حسینہ یا حسین بال کھولے کون مکتب میں صدا پڑھتا ہے. سلام
على حب فاطمة الزهراء صلوا على محمد وآل محمد.
الله صل على محمد وآل محمد.
لتعجيل فرج الإمام صاحب العصر والزمان صلوا على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
Let's please have a surah al-Fatiha for the deceased members of the sponsor's family. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والحمد لله رب العالمين. صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله. صلى الله عليك وعلى أهل بيتك المعصومين المظلومين المنتكبين. صلى الله عليك يا مولاي وابن يا أبا عبد الله الحسين وعلى الأرواح التي استشهدت بين يدي الحسين وعلى السبايا من أهله وذوي ما خاب والله من تمسك بكم وأمن من لجأ والتجأ إليكم. يا ليتنا فيا ليتنا كنا معكم فنفوز فوزا عظيما. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في محكم كتابه المبين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وجاهدوا في الله حق جهاده هو اجتباكم وما جعل عليكم في الدين من حرج ملة أبيكم إبراهيم هو سماكم المسلمين من قبل وفي هذا ليكون الرسول شهيدا عليكم وتكونوا شهداء على الناس. فأقيموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة واعتصموا بالله هو مولاكم فنعم المولى ونعم النصير. آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. والسلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Brothers and sisters, I know everyone is very tired after a long 13 days. So tonight I will only go about 2.5 hours. الصلوات على محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد.
Usually it's at that stage that you start throwing eggs or rotten tomatoes or something at me. I've already given permission to Brother Farasat that if I go longer than half an hour, he can start throwing food.
Remote control. He's ready.
Forget, remote control won't stop me. I'm gonna keep talking. You need to just take something big and heavy and throw it at me and that's it. Inshallah, I will try to keep it a little simple. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah in Surah Al-Hajj, the 22nd surah of the Quran, he says, وَجَاهِدُوا فِي اللَّهِ حَقَّ جِهَادِهِ. Strive in the way of Allah, in the way that is befitting of Allah. حَقَّ جِهَادِهِ. And there is a long explanation of what this is as well. And again, it is not about us going and killing ourselves or killing other people. That's not the jihad. The bigger jihad is the fight against the nafs, the fight against our own lower self. The Quran in this ayah says, وَاجْتَبَاكُمْ وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. Allah says that I am the one who is chosen amongst you, and I have given you a deen, I have given you a religion. And in this religion, there is no haraj. There is no difficulty, there is no hardship, in the sense that there is something about this religion that is very good for you. And it is the millah, it is the way of your grandfather Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, who is the one, or who's during whose time Allah named you the Muslimin. He called you the Muslimin. And he says, وَفِي هَذَا لِيَكُونَ رَسُولٌ شَهِيدًا عَلَيْكُمْ. So that Rasul will now be a witness. Now we've said this, that the position of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is so great, that how can someone be shaheed, a witness, if he has not been there from the very beginning? If Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is the shaheed, وَجِئْنَا بِكَ عَلَىٰ هَؤُلَاءِ شَهِيدًا. That Ya Rasul, Ya Habib, we have made you a shaheed over everyone. So that means he must have been there from the very beginning. There is no way that he came at the end of all of those Anbiya and Mursaleen. He had to have been the first of Allah's creation to be the shaheed over everyone. And then there is another group of people who are also going to be shaheed with Rasulullah, after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And these people are going to bear witness, and then the warning of Allah comes that says, فَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةُ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةُ. Make sure you uphold your prayer. Salat is the hamud of your religion. It is the pillar. It is the post that if you don't have salat, you don't have proper salat, your religion will fall apart. And give the zakat. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِاللَّهِ. This ayah is so beautiful. Hold on, come together. Come together for the purpose of Allah. Hold on to Allah, come together for Allah's purpose. And remember that huwa mawlaakum, Allah is your mawla. He is your master. And he says, فَنِعْمَ الْمَوْلَى وَنِعْمَ النَّصِيرُ. There is no better master than Allah. And there is no better nasir. There is no one better who can support you in your cause and whatever you want to achieve. And so there's so much in this one ayah. You can talk for days and days and days and still not finish. But the ayah talks about the deen, about your religion, that follow your deen. And so if you look, I will focus inshallah only on this small part, the deen itself. The deen itself, what is religion? That, you know, you go to the Webster's Dictionary or you look at some of the other definitions, that religion is a set of beliefs. It is a code of practice, a code of worshipping a god of some sort, or in some religions, many gods. It is a way to pray. It's a way for people to come together. It is a way of sort of organizing people based on a set of beliefs. They say that the Quran, or the Quran in a very nice way, describes what is deen. It tells you what is deen and how you should understand what deen is. And you all know this ayah, فَأَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ لِلدِّينِ حَنِيفًا. Turn your face and follow the religion hanif, sincerely, follow your religion sincerely.
فطرت الله التي فطر الناس عليها.
It is the very basic nature that Allah has created you on. It is the fitra that Allah has created you on.
لا تبديل لخلق الله.
There is no changing Allah's religion. So they say, one day somebody asked Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wa salam.
Allah.
Ya Rasulullah. That Allah says, فَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ لِلدِّينِ حَنِيفًا فِطْرَةُ اللَّهِ الَّذِي فَطَرَ النَّاسِ عَلَيْهَا. Follow your religion sincerely the way you're supposed to. This is the fitrah. This is the very nature that Allah has created inside of you. What is this fitrah? So Imam al-Sadiq, alayhi salatu wasalam, he answered with one word, well, two words, but really one word. He says, هُوَ التَّوْحِيد. He says, you want to know what that fitrah is, your nature? He says, it is Tawheed. It is the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the man asks, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, can you explain further? We know what Tawheed is, to believe in one God. What does it mean? He says, Ma'rifatullah. It is to know Allah. That is your deen. And the very nice explanation the ulama gave him, that what is your deen? It is the recognition or recognizing that in every second, every moment, from the minute you come into this world till the minute you die, that there is a supreme power that is controlling everything. And that you have no control over anything. You have absolutely no control. It is all in this control. That is deen. The ma'rifah that Allah controls everything and you have control of nothing. He is the owner of everything and you are the owner of nothing. He knows everything and you know nothing. He has given you everything, you have done nothing to take it or to achieve it. Because it is his generosity that has given it to you. In every way, it obliviates, it takes away our own existence, it knocks us away. And that deen is a very great thing. I mentioned this to you before, but the Imams explained to us that if we want to have ma'rifah, understanding our religion, there are basically four things. Imam described, I believe it's Imam al-Kadhim, alayhi salatu wa salam. Imam describes that there are four things that you should know. You want to have ma'rifah for your religion, what Allah is trying to teach you, four things you should know. And these four things, brothers and sisters, believe me, they're so simple. But if we ask ourselves about these four things every day, we won't slip from our religion. We will be on our religion the way we are supposed to. One, the first thing, you must have ma'rifah of Allah. So when someone asks the Imam, yes, we know Allah is one, we know God is one, but what does it mean to have ma'rifah? He says, you must know the lutf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have to know the latif. In this case, what does it mean to have lutf? Lutf means you know the subtlety of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know the subtlety of how Allah is taking care of you, how Allah is present with you all the time. A very nice example someone told me is that when you get sick, when you get very sick and you have a fever the entire night, right? You're suffering through a high fever, you have 104 degree fever, you cannot sleep, your body's aching, you're suffering, and you're thinking to yourself, Ya Allah, why am I suffering like this? Why am I suffering like this? This is a great trial, this is a great pain on my body. But the Imam says, and even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, he says that if you spend one night in fever, Allah will erase thousands of your sins away. We see the fever as a pain, as a difficulty, as a trial. And yet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, one night in fever for a believer means the washing away, the absolving of his sins. This is the lutf of Allah. We don't see it, but it is always there. The second thing is to recognize what Allah has done with us. Allah has given us lots of ni'mah, lots of gifts. And Imam says to be able to recognize those gifts in the right way is what is going to allow us to have proper shukr. You must have shukr. To be able to recognize the risk. The one very simple question is, yes, maybe we thank Allah for the food that goes in our mouth, but the water that we drink, the clothes we are wearing, the house that we have. But have we thanked Allah for every breath that He lets us take? That's a ni'mah of God. And if we are not thanking him for it, we have become ghafil of it. We have become heedless. The third thing that the Imam describes is that Allah wants you to know how you should act so that you can earn the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your salat must have a certain amount of effort, certain amount of concentration. Your fasting must have a certain amount of sincerity. Your zakat, all of your actions must be so good that you earn the thawab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the fourth thing that the Imam says, and this is the most important, I think, is that you must know what is going to take you out of your religion. The fourth thing, you must know that which will take you away from deen. Brothers and sisters, this is how we know our religion. This is how we understand our religion. And that religion is very important. That deen is important that we understand what that is. Because if you have a problem, you want it to be in anything other than your deen. They say Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, he would say, Ya Rab, la taj'al musibati fi deeni. He says, Ya Allah, don't allow my difficulties ever to be in my religion or of my religion. Allow my difficulty to be about my body, about my children, about my life, about my money, but never difficulty about my religion. Allow my religion to be sound. They say Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, the Imam, in one of his wills, he said to his children, Imam Ali says, إِذَا حَضَرَتْ بَلِيَّةٌ فَجْعَلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ دُونَ أَنفُسِكُمْ. If a difficulty comes upon you, the first thing you should do is separate your money away from yourself. Separate your money. Now, this is an interesting thing, because what's the first thing we want to do? A problem comes, we want to throw money on it, right? you would say, I have a problem, let me see if I can buy my way out of it. Isn't it? Or let me see what I can do to get it. But Imam is warning. He says, what you may do to get away from that badiyah is to haram with your money. That will cause you problems. The next thing he says, وَإِذَا نَزَلَتْ نَازِلَةٌ فَاجْعَلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ دُونَ دِينِكُمْ. He says, if a problem is upon you, a difficulty is upon you, a mushkilah is upon you, he said, separate yourself from your religion. Meaning, don't leave your religion, but make sure you preserve your religion, even though it means sacrificing or paining your own self. Preserve your religion, even though it means it's hard on you, it's difficult for you. Preserve your religion. Suffer it physically, but preserve your religion. Do not give away your religion. Hold on to that religion that is very important. He says, فَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ الْحَالِفْ مَنْ هَلَكَ دِينُ. The true person who has become destroyed is the one whose religion is destroyed. Someone whose religion becomes destroyed, they are the true halik. They are the true person who have been destroyed, basically, annihilated. Now, one of the things that the marja al-taqlid, the maraja, and even Sayyid Sistani writes about this in one of his books, is a concept known as at-ta'arrub ba'd al-hijra. At-ta'arrub ba'd al-hijra. It is a concept that basically, if you translate from the Arabic, at-ta'arrub ba'd al-hijra means losing your faith or your iman after you migrate, after you emigrate. All right? Not immigrate, emigrate. At-ta'arrub ba'd al-hijra. It means you leave your country, a Muslim country, and you come to a non-Muslim country, you do hijrah, and you come to a Western non-Muslim country, and as a result of your hijrah, as a result of your move to this Western country, what happens to you? You lose your iman. You lose your faith. This is called at-ta'arrub ba'd al-hijrah. At-ta'arrub ba'd al-hijrah, and I'm mentioning this now, because really, the vast majority of us are in this category, in the sense that we are susceptible to this, na'udhu billah, wal'ayyadu billah. That we have left our homes, Muslim countries, to come to the West to find some benefit, to find some peace in our lives, something good for our children. And yet, because the society is not like a Muslim society, even though it is open, it gives you the freedom to practice and do, and that is something we must recognize. But there is constant temptation. At-ta'arrub ba'd al-hijrah. And so what is the question? In fact, there are riwayat, there are some traditions of the Ahl al-Bayt alayhi salatu wa salam that say that ta'arrub ba'd al-hijra, losing your iman after leaving your Muslim country to come to a Western country, is a kabira. It is a great sin. So much so that Sayyid Sistani even says that if you are at risk of losing your faith, you must leave. You must leave and go back. And I'm not trying to say this to you to threaten anyone or to scare anybody, but to be aware. And now they explain, the scholars explain, that this means at ta'arrub ba'd al-hijra, losing your faith after doing the migration, coming to it means you have left the wajibat of your religion. You have left the fara'id. You have stopped praying. You have stopped fasting. You have stopped giving khums. You are not giving zakat. You are not doing the things that you are supposed to do. And on top of that, you are doing big haram acts. Small haram, everyone does now. Small haram, everyone does it because we are not Muslim. But big haram acts that we are willfully doing. He says, these people are at great risk. Why? Because they have left their religion. They have left their religion. Notice, did the Sayyid say, or the scholar say anything about language? No. Even in his recommendations, he says, okay, maybe if the child has Arabic parents, do everything you can to teach them Arabic, but if you can't, that's okay. As long as they can do their salat in proper Arabic. As long as they can read Quran in proper Arabic, don't worry about whether they can speak it or not, necessarily. Try to teach them, but if they cannot, make sure the basic ibadah they can do. Make sure they can do it, so they don't lose. Make sure that the recommendation is they hold on and they know the basic of their religion. What they must do, how they must act. The prayers, the zakat, the sawm, all of these things they must do. They must know them. They must know what is haram. They must stay away from situations in which there is haram. Stay away from places where there is alcohol being drank. Stay away from places where there is gambling. Why? Because eventually, you may say to yourself, well, I'm going here. I don't drink, I don't gamble, I don't do any of these things. I'm just going to go and be amongst those people because they are my colleagues or they are my friends. But eventually, it's going to draw you. It's going to pull you. It's going to have an effect on you. And you must stay away from that. Because again, deen is about strength, how much strength you have to follow, how much forbearance you have, and how you behave. And one of the things that is very greatly recommended is that have places where you can come together, where you can remind yourselves, where you can strengthen. And what does the ayah say? وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِاللَّهِ وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِاللَّهِ Come together for Allah. Come together for Allah. Why? Because the minute I become weak, one of you will remind me. Or if someone sees someone else slipping or doing something haram, you can remind them gently and say, look, that's not good for you. Come back to the fold of Islam. Don't slip. Don't slip away from it. It's about creating our identity. And many of us, I would say this for myself first, that I'm an American. I'm more American than I am anything else. I dress like an American. I talk like an American. I eat American food. I watch American sports, TV, etc. But that doesn't mean that I'm not a Muslim, or that I'm not a follower of my religion, or that I'm not doing the things I have to do. And so again, we migrate, and maybe we lose that Pakistani culture, or that Indian culture, or that Irani culture, or that Iraqi culture. It's okay. And I know some people may disagree with me for saying that. It's okay. As long as you don't lose your religion. لا تجعل مصيبتي في ديني. Don't allow my musibah to be in my religion. Culture, let it go. Language, let it go. All of that, let it go. Don't lose religion. Don't lose your religion. Don't lose your religion. Whatever you do, don't lose your religion. Salawat ala Muhammad. Brothers and sisters, the beauty of this religion that we follow is that it has given us the code in every way. And that code is simple, because it applies to every aspect of our life. And the greatest thing is that the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, when he was telling Imam Ali alayhi salatu wa salam, he was giving him some advice. The first of the advice, one of the first advice that he gave him is that, Ya Ali, you must have tafaqquh fi al-deen. Tafaqquh fi al-deen. And what does that mean? Fiqh, it just means the jurisprudence, the law. But in this case, tafaqquh means you go and you study the religion. You look at what the religion is saying to you. And if you don't know, you have to go search. And if you don't know where to search, ask somebody, they'll give you a book. Trust me, everything is available today. Everything is there. And the more we study, the more we will know. And we cannot be of those people who say, well, I don't know, and I'm going to choose not to know so I can continue to do wrong things. It's easy. It's easy to say, well, no, I'm not going to look at it, or I'm not going to follow it. And if I don't look at it, then I won't be held accountable. Ignorance is not an excuse. It is an excuse up to a certain point, but eventually Allah says, no, you knew. You knew. You came to the Majlis of Imam Hussein. You came to the mosque for Friday prayers, so you knew. You must follow. And it is difficult. You know why? Because human beings form habits. Habits are hard to break, particularly here in America. I'll give you my own personal example. That growing up in America, you pick up the habits of people in school. You pick up the habits of children who were your classmates. And those habits become a part of your life. And you just keep doing it because you don't know anything. And as you get older, you cannot leave that habit. And you learn later on that, well, this habit that I was doing, it is completely haram. And now it's hard to break. And so we must, from the very beginning, teach our children the habits of Islam. Try not to look at things you're not supposed to look at. Don't listen to things you're not supposed to listen to. Don't be around things you're not supposed to be around. Have a distinct identity that is yours. Make sure. And the other thing, brothers and sisters, I will finish with this, is that our deen, the deen of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, is the deen of the social aspect. This religion, the religion not only teaches you, why do we have religion? Some people can say, well, why don't you just be a good person and that's sufficient? Why do I have to believe in God and believe in a religion or have a code or any of it? Why do I need all of this? You don't need it. Well, don't you want to know what your purpose is? You have to have a purpose. And don't you have to live by a standard? Strangely enough, we will live in society and we will follow the rules. We will obey the speed limit most of the time, hopefully. Stop at a red light. Go to a grocery store, and if we buy a loaf of bread, we pay for it, hopefully, and not just slip it into our bag, right? It's absurd to think that we would break those rules, right? Would you walk into a bank and say, give me $100? Would you? Nirvana thinks that's fun. Nirvana, I hope you're not doing that.
He does that?
I'm like bankrupt.
Yeah, but you have money if you're doing that? Jalalpa, you've not been teaching them properly. Or maybe you have, but that's why you're there.
He is teaching properly.
Again, it's absurd to think that you would break the rule, right? Or you're speeding, you get stopped by the police officer, and he says, do you know how fast you were going? And that's always the question they ask. I don't know why. Well, obviously, I knew how fast I was going. I wasn't just depressing my foot just like that. But it would be absurd to say when the police officer comes to you and says license and registration, you say, I'm not going to give it to you. Bye-bye. And you say, bye. How many people would do that? Oh, you have a few hands. And they're all under the age of 7. Wait till you get a driver's license. Wait till you get a driver's license, if your parents even give you those at this point now, after you raise your hands. You have forever soiled yourselves, and now you're never going to get a driver's license. But in all honesty, which one is going to blatantly defy the rule, right? So for our society in which we live, there has to be a rule. Everyone follows the rule. Most people follow the rules, right? So why is it that for life in general, there shouldn't be rules? There shouldn't be a code by which you should live. There has to be. And so religion, deen, teaches you not only how to worship, how to pray, how to speak to your creator, how to speak to your Lord, but it also teaches you how to have character, how to have qirdaan, how to have your akhlaq, the adab that you have. And it also teaches you the social aspect. That's why we have deen, because it teaches you the answer to everything. That's the beauty of this religion. And that's the beauty of the followers of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad alayhi salatu wa
sallam.
That in this madhab, particularly for us and others as well who consider this to be correct, when Rasulullah left this world, the religion was complete. And not only was the religion complete, there was an answer to every question until the day of judgment. We have to believe that. That even today, some people ask, someone asked me, well, the internet's not mentioned in the Quran. Satellite is not mentioned in the Quran. Well, not the planetary satellites, but the real electronic satellites. Other things are not mentioned in the Quran. So how do we know? The Quran is for all time, our religion is for all time, how do we know the answers? Deen is supposed to, religion is supposed to give you an answer. And a very nice answer that one of my brothers actually shared with me, that I had not really even thought of it this way, but is a very nice answer, is that, okay, maybe internet is not mentioned by name in the Quran, but it will tell you how you should behave. Maybe Quran doesn't by name talk about Western banks or mortgages necessarily or other social issues, but it will tell you how to act with reference to them. And not only will it tell you, we have authentic ahadith traditions that are going to give you an indication of how you should behave. We must believe that there is an indication of how we should behave. That's why you have religion. Because it's going to tell you in every circumstance what you need to do, how you should behave, how you should act. It's an indicator, it's a pointer. If you go to a foreign city, you get yourself a Mercedes as a rental, but you don't have a map to tell you which streets to drive, where to turn, where to go, are you going to be able to get anywhere? No, that's a nice Mercedes you have. It probably drives real smooth, but you're not going to get anywhere very fast, right? Same in life. You have religion for that purpose. And finally, the social aspect, like I said, that deen is going to teach you how you must interact with each other, how you must be with each other, how you must treat an orphan or the elderly or the poor or someone in need of help, or when there's a contract being done between two people, what are the rules? Or when you give a loan to someone, what are the rules? All of these are spelled out in the religion of Islam. They say that in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, that when Rasulullah was sending his emissaries out to the visit to the other nations, to the surrounding nations, he sent an emissary to Yemen. He sent Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam to Yemen. He sent some emissaries to Rome. He sent some to Persia. He sent all over the place. One of the emissaries went to the Roman Empire, and he came to the Roman Emperor, and you've heard this story before, and they brought this letter saying that my name is Muhammad, I am the Prophet, the Messenger of Allah, calling you to the worship of one God, and to follow the religion, the proper religion. So now this emperor, he wanted to know, he said, this letter is fine and good, it's just a letter, I have no indication of what Muhammad is like. So someone tell me, what is he like? So some of his counselors, they said, oh, Emperor, one of the people from his community is here on trade. They are trading here in our kingdom. He says, summon them, call them. So they call them. This person comes, this person who is from Arabia, from Hijaz, from Mecca. He knows Rasulullah. They say he comes, and the emperor asks, he says, tell me about this man, Muhammad. And there are many questions, and I will only quote some of them for you. The emperor asks, he says, this man, Muhammad, does he dress like a king? Does he wear a crown on his head and a robe and gold? And says, no, he doesn't wear a robe. He wears the simplest of clothes.
so that if you were to come into a room and everyone is dressed alike, you would not be able to tell him who he is, where is he. The emperor asks, he says, are his followers increasing or are they decreasing? Are their numbers going up or are their numbers going down? The man says, no, their numbers are going up. The numbers are going up, they're not going down. The emperor asks, when you see him sitting in a company of people, is he sitting with rich people who are dignitaries, wealthy people, or is he sitting with the poor people? The man says, no, emperor, he sits with the poor people. He's only seen sitting with the poor people in the dirt next to them. He's always sitting next to them. The emperor says, describe to me his home. Is his home like a palace with gold and ornament and decoration? The man says, no, this man, Muhammad, he lives in the simplest of homes. There is nothing in his home. It is a dirt floor. There is nothing. It is the most simple and the most, of the rudimentary homes. There are many questions that go on. He asks him, how does he treat his followers? How does he treat the people? He says he treats them with honesty, dignity, and absolute reverence for humanity. He treats them all kindly, every single one of them. Brothers and sisters, do you know who this person was who was telling the emperor all of these answers? It was Abu Sufyan. It was Abu Sufyan, the enemy of Rasulullah, the enemy of Islam, who was giving this answer. And when asked that, Abu Sufyan, the emperor asked him, he says, are you his friend or are you his enemy? He says, no, I am his enemy. I am his enemy. It was at that time, before he had become a Muslim. So close. He said, I am his enemy, but I cannot lie as to what he is. I cannot lie what he is. This is what deen is about. This is what deen shows us. That if at any point anyone asks you what is a Muslim, the answers that Abu Sufyan gave about Rasulullah should be given about our religion. Because that's the whole of religion. That's what and this is what we are teaching our children. That my child, when you sit in a group of people, you feed the elderly first. Don't eat yourself. When you sit in a group of people, make sure you sit with respect and humility. My child, when you go and pray, make sure you pray in the proper way. My child, when you go out into the public, speak in a soft voice. Keep your head down to the ground. Be humble, like the son of Luqman is exhorted to do in the Holy Quran. All of these things, these akhlaq, we are teaching because of religion. And we are holding on to them because of religion. And this was the fight of Imam Hussein, alayhi salatu wasalam. But when Imam Hussein went out to the battlefield, he went wild. To allow this legacy to survive. And in some way, we are doing it, but we are not doing it with the sword. We are fighting to keep our identity and our religion, and it is hard in this country. It's very hard. It's hard in the Muslim countries these days to keep your identity and who you are. But believe me, if you do it, you will see the rewards. Not only in this life, but in the Akhirah as well. It is related that after the tents were burned, the tents were burned on the 10th of Muharram. And I said this before, but the price that was paid at Karbala for our religion to be here with us today was a very big price. The price that was paid for us to be mu'min today, Muslim today, sitting in this room, remembering Imam Hussein, was a very big price that was given by the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is something that my words, nobody's words can justify. They cannot do credit to what was given in that place. And so it is said that when the tents were burned and all the ladies were coming out, they say that the soldiers of Umar ibn Sa'ad, they went and started to loot every piece of property. They went to loot the clothes, the swords, the armor. They snatched the earrings from the ears of the daughters of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Even an Imam Abi Abdullah and Hussein, they did not leave the shirt on his body. So much so that when Imam Hussein, before he went out to the battlefield, he said to his sister Sayyidah Zainab, that, oh my sister Zainab, give me a shirt such that they will not want to take it off of my body. It will be so torn and so simple that they will not want to steal it from me, because I know they will desecrate my body and rob me of my possessions. They went and they stole everything.
And the story says, وفرّت بنات الزهراء حسرات باكيات. The daughters of Fatima al-Zahra, the daughters of Rasulullah, they were running in every direction away from the burning tents. The enemy soldiers were not being kind to them. They were not protecting them. There was no mercy towards the daughters of Rasulullah. They say that one by one they were gathered all into an area. The ropes were tied on their hands. They were shackled with iron around their necks. They say in the history, one of the men who had observed the events of Karbala, a man named Hamid ibn Muslim, described that I was with the army of Umar ibn Sa'd after Abi Abdullah al-Hussein had been murdered. We came into the tent, some of the soldiers and I entered into the tent. We noticed that there was a young man lying on the bed, and he was very sick. He was sick from fever and turning over in pain. The enemy soldiers said to each other, shall we now go and kill this young boy while he is lying? He is vulnerable. Hamid ibn Muslim steps forward and he says, I stopped the enemy soldiers and said to them, have you not done enough to his father and to those other relatives of his? Can you not see that he is lying sick? Leave him be and do not attack him, do not harm him. The enemy soldiers come towards the bed of Imam Ali Zain al-Abidin. They do not leave him lying there. It is described in the history that they pull the bed out from underneath him and they drop him to the ground. Imam Zain al-Abidin is lying on the ground, shivering from the fever and turning over in his pain. Then the body of al-Hussein is lying on the sand. And Imam Zain al-Abidin describes that Shimr calls out to his soldiers. And he says to the soldiers, which one of you will go and trample the body of al-Hussein? Which one of you will go and ride his horse on the body of al-Hussein? They say the 10% soldiers come forward. They get on top of their horses. They begin to ride their horses on the body of Imam al-Hussein. The feet of the horses are trampling on the body of Imam al-Hussein. One of the historians questions and he says, if those horses knew whose body was lying under their feet, those horses certainly would not have trampled that body. They trampled and began to press down on the body, such that it is described that the chest had collapsed and was touching the back of Imam Hussein's body. It has become demolished, all the bones have been crushed. Imam Zain al-Abidin is watching all of this. He is watching to see how is he supposed to bear. In the history, it is described that from the pain on his face, Al-Hafila Zainab al-Kubra came to him. She said to him, O son of my brother, why do I see you looking like this? Why do I see you in the pain like this? He says to her, Ya Abnati Zainab,
Zainab. Oh my Aunt Zainab, how can I not be bewildered when I have just watched my father killed in front of my eyes? When I have watched my brothers and my uncles killed in front of my eyes? The enemy did not even leave his body. They trampled and destroyed the body of the friends and of the Sulaw. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك ونقسم عليك بحق الزهراء وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها لعن الله ظالمها اللهم شافي كل مريض اللهم رد كل غريب اللهم فك كل أسير اللهم غير سوء حالنا بحسن حالك يا كريم اللهم وفقنا لمراضيك وجنبنا معاصيك وثبت أقدامنا على صراطك المستقيم وخذ بأيدينا إليك يا أرحم الراحمين وفرج عنا يا الله فرجا عاجلا قريبا كلمح البصر هو اقرب من ذلك وافرغ علينا صبرا وتوفنا مسلمين والصلاه والسلام على سيدنا محمد واله الطيبين الطاهرين صلى الله عليه
وسلم
हाथेन से घर जाएगी ज़ैनब जब होके
हाथेन से घर जाएगी ज़ैनब
जब होके
हाथेन से घर जाएगी ज़ैनब
जब होके
हाथेन से घर जाएगी ज़ैनब
जब होके
रिहा कैद से घर जाएगी ज़ैनब
घर तुम ना हुए साथ तो घर तुम ना हुए साथ तो मर जाएगी ज़ैनब
जब होके रिहा कैद से घर जाएगी ज़ैनब
जब होके
रिहा कैद से घर जाएगी ज़ैनब
अच्छा मैं चली जानिबे जिंदा मेरे भैया करती हुई मातम तेरा पढ़ती हुई नौहा सीने पे लिए जख्म जिगर जाएगी ज़ैनब
जब होके रिहा कैद से घर जाएगी ज़ैनब
जब होके
रिहा कैद से घर जाएगी ज़ैनब
تم قتل ہوئے اور اجل مجھ کو نہ آئی کس طرح سے زندہ ہوں نہ پوچھو میرے بھائی ڈھونڈے گی تمہیں اب تو یہ در جائے گی زینب جب ہو کے رہا قید سے گھر جائے گی زینب جب ہو کے رہا قید سے گھر جائے گی زینب بھائی تیری مظلومی کی کھاتی ہوں قسم میں باہر در زندہ سے نہ رکھوں بھی قدم میں جب تک نہ فنا ظلم کو کر جائے گی زینب جب ہو کے رہا قید سے گھر جائے گی زینب جب ہو کے رہا قید سے گھر جائے گی زینب گر تم نہ ہوئے ساتھ تو گر تم نہ ہوئے ساتھ تو مر جائے گی زینب جب ہو گے رہا قید سے گھر جائے گی زینب جب ہو گے رہا قید سے گھر جائے گی زینب
میں شوم می رسد ہر لحظه بوی کربلا می برد عشق حسین ما را به سوی کربلا حسین جانم حسین جانم حسین جانم حسین جانم تا بگیرم در بغل قبر حسین ابن علی آمدم من کو به کو در جست و جوی کربلا حسین جانم
حسین جانم
حسین جانم حسین جانم گر که من آلوده ام اما شدم مهمان تو تا بگیرم آبرو از آبروی کربلا تشنه آب فراقم ای اجل مهلت بده تا بنوشم جرعه جرعه از سبوی کربلا در بیابان طلب چون لاله های داغ دار دل سرا با شعله شد در آرزوی کربلا حسین جانم
حسین جانم
حسین جانم حسین جانم حرف دیگر خوش نباشد در میان عاشقان جز حسین ابن علی جز گفت و گوی کربلا حسین جانم
حسین جانم
حسین جانم حسین جانم در مسیر کربلا از جان و سر خواهم گذشت گر ببندد راه را بر من عدوی کربلا حسین جانم
حسین جانم
حسین جانم حسین جانم تا که بنشیند بابا رضا برینش بر روخم میزنم خیمه یه دل من رو به روی کربلا
حسین جانم
حسین جانم
حسین جانم
السلام على صاحب السكينة، السلام على المدفون بالمدينة، السلام على العلم المؤيد، السلام على أبي القاسم محمد ورحمة الله وبركاته، السلام على سيدتنا ومولاتنا أم المؤمنين خديجة الكبرى ورحمة الله وبركاته، السلام على سيدنا ومولانا وصي رسول الله وخليفته من بعده إمام المتقين أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام على سيدتنا ومولاتنا المحدثة العليمة بضعة رسول الله فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام على صدقي الرحمة وإمامينهما الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والخلق الهادي المهدي الإمام القائم الحجة عجل الله تعالى فرجه وسهل مخرجه وجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه والدادين عنه ورحمة الله وبركاته. إلهي بحق فاطمة وأبيها وبحلها وبنيها شافي مرضانا يا الله. اللهم اقضي حوائجنا حوائج الدنيا والآخرة. اللهم لا تسلط علينا وعلى المسلمين من لا يرحمه. إلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات ومن مات على الإيمان ولا سيما أموات الحاضرين رحم الله من أهدى ثواب الفاتحة تسبقها الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد.